about you, but I'm excited.
Come on,
yeah. I'm excited this morning.
Now.
100 years.
Woo.
100 years.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Before we sing this next song, how many have experienced the goodness of God?
Yes.
Oh, I know you can do better than that.
Yes.
How many have experienced the goodness of God? When I think about this song, I think about the 100 years that God has been running after this church, running after the people of God. I got a couple of scriptures and a little bit I want to say. In Psalms 23:6, it says, "Surely your goodness and unfailing love will pursue me all the days of my life, and I will live in the house of the Lord forever." Forever. Pursue is to run. To run after something. That's how God is. He chases us. Psalm 31:19 says, "Oh, how great is thy goodness, which thou hast laid up for them that fear thee, which thou hast wrought for them that trust in thee before the sons of men." How great is thy goodness. How great. God has been good to us, Lighthouse. Lighthouse, do you know that God has relentlessly pursued us and ran after us with a fathomless passion? His loving kindness and compassion ran after us when we moved 2 times, when we fought against the city of Southfield, yes, for a building that is still now sitting empty with our Lighthouse logo on the door. Can you believe that? But through all of the trials, God's goodness still runs after us. God's goodness sent us here on the corner of 6 Mile and Kinlock. Hallelujah. God's compassion and undying love has continued to run after us for these 100 years that we celebrate today. And it will continue. The legacy will continue through our children and their children. God has never left, nor has he forsaken us, Lighthouse. His mercies have never failed us. His undying love has never run out of steam for this church, Lighthouse Community Church of God. We went through COVID. We lost some loved ones, but we are still standing. We maintained, didn't have to shut the doors of the church like so many. We are still here. His goodness is running after us, church. Let's continue to surrender everything to the Lord and stay committed and faithful to the Lord, faithful to the call. Let's stay faithful. Lighthouse, if we stay faithful, his goodness will keep running after us. Amen. 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 Hallelujah.
From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so good. With every breath that I am able, of the goodness of God.
Thank you, Lord.
I love your voice.
Hallelujah.
You have led me through the fire in darkest nights. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God.
Let's have everybody sing that.
All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able,
thank you, Lord.
Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, is running.
If you're able, I'm going to ask you to stand for prayer. Our God has been too good. He's been better than we could have ever asked. He has given us what we never deserved. My God, what an awesome
Thank
God.
You, Lord.
What an awesome God. It is prayer time. And we believe here that God still answers prayer.
Yes,
we believe that our God is amazing. and that there's nothing he can't do. We see miracles. If you look around you, you see miracles all throughout the house today. Our God, he's faithful. He's good. He's merciful. He's a healer. He's a deliverer. He's a sustainer. That's our God. I know there are needs in the house. If you have an urgent need, just raise your hand. Amen. Amen. The beautiful thing about God is he knows what's going on. And he promised to take care of every need of every one of his children. That's the promise of God. And I'm standing here today as a witness to tell you that God has never come short of any promise that he has ever made. Would you pray with me? Father, today we just want to say thank you first. We thank you, Lord, that you are here. Your presence is here. We feel your presence in the house today. And we are grateful, God. We thank you that you are such a kind and merciful God. We thank you that you're a God who doesn't break a promise, God. We have to confess, Lord, people have broken promises to us. And some of us struggle, Lord, to believe that you're that good. But God, we know today you're just that good. And we just want to say thank you, Father. We just want to thank you for allowing us the health and the strength to be able to be in the house today, God. It's so good to look out and see folk, God, who haven't been able to be here. But today, Lord, you bless them to be able to gather together in the house of God. And we say thank you this morning, Lord. We bless your name, your awesome God. Father, you saw every hand that went up. You know every need in this house today. You know every desire that's in our hearts today, God. You know everything, Lord, that we are standing here looking to you to fulfill today, God. There are physical needs in the house today, Lord. Some folks' bodies are not cooperating with them, God. Some have heard news from a doctor, Lord, that wasn't so favorable. But God, you are the God, Lord, who speaks those things that were not as though they were. And so we put it in your hands today, Lord. There are folks here today, Lord, with some financial needs. They got some things going on, Lord, and they've tried every way they knew, but they need a deliverance. They need a miracle. They need something from you today, God. And so we ask you, Lord, to meet their need. There's some, Lord, some mental needs in the house today, God. There's some folks struggling, Lord, with their mind today. And we ask you, Lord, as we've heard folks say, you are a mind regulator, Lord. And we know you're able, Lord, to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we could ask or think, God. And so we put them in your hands today, Lord. Father, there's some relational needs in the house today, Lord. There's some marriages that are in trouble today, God, and they need you to help them reconcile some things, Lord. They need you to help them work out some stuff, God. Remind them, Lord, of the vows that they took. Remind them, Lord, of the good days, Father, and help them, Lord, to work through and sort through. And if they need help, Lord, help them to find counselors that are able to help them today. But God, meet their needs today. There's some family needs today, Lord. We got folks who haven't spoken to family, Lord, in a while because of some misunderstandings, Lord, because of some things that didn't go quite right. We're asking you in Jesus' name, Lord, to help them to reconcile, God. Bring them together, Lord. Help them to talk for the first time in a long time, Lord. And then, God, most of all, there's some spiritual needs in the house today. There's some folks even standing in the room today who have come because their hearts are broken, God, because people have lied to them. Folks have let them down. And, Lord, they're in trouble today. They need Jesus today, God. And we're asking you in the name of Jesus, Lord, that you would speak to their heart, Lord, that the Holy Spirit will begin to trouble the heart and let them know, I am here. I've been looking for you. I've been coming after you, Father. And I have something for you. I have a gift for you. His name is Jesus. He's what you need today. He's the one that can help you sort out everything going on in your life. Father, I pray today that every need is met in this house today. That, Father, your will would be done today. Lord, our world is in trouble. I know you know that, God.
Yes, it is.
But you said in your word that if my people who are called by my name would humble themselves, they would seek my face and turn from their wicked ways.
Yes,
you said, then will I hear from heaven.
Yes, God.
I will forgive their sins and I will heal their land.
Amen.
We stand
Amen.
On that today, God. Because we need you, Lord.
Need you,
our governments need you, Lord.
Need
local
you, Lord.
And state and national and international, God. We need help, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Help, Lord. Touch our leaders, God. Yes. Turn the hearts of the kings, God, those in charge, Lord. Let them know they need a Savior. They need wisdom. God. They need understanding, God.
Thank you, Father.
They need, Lord, in Jesus' name.
Thank you,
and help us as the people of God to be on our post, to pray, Lord, to pray and pray much, God, to believe by faith, Lord, without doubting, and watch God work.
Yes.
Lord, have your way.
Have your way.
Have your way now.
Have your way.
In Jesus' name.
Thank you, Father.
In Jesus' name.
Jesus.
The name that is above every other name.
Yes, God.
We thank you.
Thank you.
We praise you.
Hallelujah.
We glorify you,
God.
Amen. Come on, give God some praise.
Yes.
Give God praise. Give God some praise today. I would ask you to remain standing for the reading of the Word of God. We stand for the reading of the Word to honor God, to let Him know how blessed we know that we are.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I will be reading Psalms 100, a psalm of thanksgiving. Shout with joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before Him singing with joy. Acknowledge that the Lord is God. He made us and we are His. We are His people and the sheep of His pasture.
Amen.
We are His people and the sheep of His pastures. Enter His gate with thanksgiving. Go into His court with praise. Give thanks to Him and praise His name. For the Lord is good.
Yes, He is.
For the Lord is good.
Yes.
His unfailing love continues forever.
Amen.
And His faithfulness continues to each generation.
Hallelujah. Amen.
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 May the Lord have a blessing on the reading
Amen.
Of His word.
Yes.
Go ahead. Well, this is the first time I've been in this facility, and you have a clean, beautiful facility. You're a very energetic group. I'm enjoying the service. And I've had the pleasure of meeting some of you back in the early days. We're breaking ground out here to do an add-on. This church has been very good to our community. And you've been good neighbors and good friends. So let me put my glasses on, because when you get older, you have to do that. All right. Charter Township of Redford, Lighthouse Community Church of God, 100-year anniversary celebration. Congratulations on 100 years, in recognition of your 100-year ministry, fellowship, dedication, dedicated service, with the township for the last 15 years. May you be proud of the many programs and activities sponsored by the church for the benefit and enjoyment of the community. You set an example to be followed with your partnership with Redford Interfaith to assist families in need. We look forward to many more years. May your light continue to shine.
Unto me
for every valley,
for at your strength. I stand amazed at your power. So amazing, amazing. I stand amazed at your glory. I stand amazed at your strength. I stand amazed at your power. So amazing, amazing. So
what a joy that is. Okay, I've said it all. Let's get her going. Are you tired of losing yet? As a church, as a movement, this post-church and now post-Christian era has caused many battles. The culture wars we have been fighting, or for some of us viewing, on social media and complaining. As a faith community, we just got over the prosperity movement. You know, the blab it and grab it, the touch and refresh it, the name it and claim it era that our church went through, and we're just getting back to doing real ministry without all the hype. And then in March 2020, we got hit with the COVID, or the Rona. Mankind's reaction to it, shut everything down. Saved humanity, shut down society. What was supposed to be a few weeks lasted for nearly 18 months. The wife and I were traveling. We do a lot of traveling. And I remember one time we were traveling from South Carolina, coming back to Ohio, and they had made the statement they were shutting down Ohio, and you had to be back in by a certain time. And we said, well, let's get us some toilet paper. And I'm going to tell you some stories today that you may say that's a lying preacher or he embellished the truth. But I say this to everybody. I give God permission to strike me dead in the pulpit so that you can say, God don't like lying preachers. So I give God permission for that. And so the wife and I, we're driving back from South Carolina, and we went through the different states and different regions. And my wife, like a woman normally do, like to shop. We were shopping for toilet paper and paper towels. We're going store after store after store. No toilet paper. I mean, we were just shocked. Mom and pop stores, big corporate chain stores, no toilet paper. And I remember Dory went into one place, ran out with one individual wrapped paper towel. I got a paper towel. Toilet paper, I got a toilet paper. I mean, it was bad, it was bad. What was going on in our nation? The effects of this COVID policy throughout our nation, people quit gathering and many quit coming to church. This quick decline of weekly church attendance, reliable volunteers, and independent or dependable church offerings have devastated many of our local congregations. Pastor Mark Richardson, we have shut down so many churches, and we didn't shut them down. They were already shut down. Some I go by on the Sunday, just see how they are, and the sign on there closed due to COVID. It's devastated our communities and devastated our local congregation. And today's state of the church or our faith community, we are losing. I mean, you can't put lipstick on the pig. You can't try to make it feel good. We are. Compared to where we were before. Where we were before, we were counterculture. And then from Constantine on forward, we became the relevant moral society in the world. People were afraid of the church. People were afraid to do something wrong. People were afraid to say something about the church. When I was growing up as a kid, we didn't even cuss in front of the church. You respected the house of God. And now the church and this movement now, we're losing. People don't respect the church. If you build it, they'll come. No longer is relevant anymore. If you have a bigger bus or a bigger van or a nice shiny van, or you have all the gadgets, even the electronic signs up front, that doesn't mean they're coming now. We're losing. For many of us, Jesus can't return soon enough. We're ready to go home. Be with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Leave it to the young folks. Leave it to the new believers. Let them fight the good fight. Let them keep the faith. Some of us, take me home, Jesus. For many of you, perhaps for many of you who have never experienced winning, your church winning, your church being on the winning side. We used to sing a song, "I'm on the winning side." After a long period of losing, perhaps your game plan is to wait it out and see what the end's going to be. And that's what some people are doing, just waiting it out. Well, I have personally experienced loss, like I'm sure many of you have. I have experienced sudden loss and long-term losing, but of course we're not here to talk about losing, are we? We're here to talk about winning. Winning. It's my job to figure out for the next 100 years plus how to help you win. It was on June the 14th, 1998, I witnessed what many would call what it takes to win. It was a long day. I got home. I got in my comfortable chair, I turned the TV on, and it was going to be a basketball game between two champions, Chicago Bulls and Utah Jazz. The previous year they had played each other and the Bulls won, and many of you know they were just decimating people. Just Gerard, you know, I know they were just decimating people. They had won three straight, then this particular person, you know, because of family events and other things, decided to retire and or quit basketball and go play some baseball. He didn't do quite well there, so then he come back, and after a few seasons, they were winning again. And they had just won two more in a row, and now they were in the final, and they're trying to figure out if they can win another three-peat. Next day, we're in this game that was between the Utah Jazz and Chicago Bulls. It was kind of like Muhammad Ali and Joe Frazier. You know, those two were always going against each other. This game was what we call the thriller in Manila. Some of y'all ask the older folks, they'll tell you about that. It wasn't on TV, it was on radio. And I remember watching this game, and on the West Coast, and what people were asking themselves, could the mailman deliver? Now, I know, ladies, some of you, and maybe some of the younger people, you may not know who's the mailman. His name was Karl Malone. He lost the previous year, and now this year, could he deliver? Could he bring a championship to the Utah Jazz? And they met, and I'm telling you, it was one of the most exciting games you have ever seen. It was Game 6, 1998, and to date, they still hold the record. This particular game, this particular series, 36.8 million people looked at this game. No other event since that time have ever come that close for NBC, CBS, or ABC in sporting events. These two Chicago Bulls and the Utah Jazz. Utah was on the West Coast, so of course you got everybody looking from that side, and then Chicago just from the Midwest, and you got everybody looking from the Midwest and the East. And because of the hype, because of who was a part of this game, these two started playing and everybody wanted to see it. I'm there with my popcorn, Betsy. I'm eating my popcorn. I got my big drink, not as big as what you got up back there, Henry, but it was pretty big. I still got good eyes. and I'm watching it, And game one, first quarter, Utah is winning. I said, okay, we'll be all right, Game, second quarter, going into halftime, Utah is winning. Coming out of halftime, I said, okay, I know they got the good speed. They're going to run it. Now they're going to turn it on. At the end of the third quarter, Utah is winning. The soon-to-be Hall of Fame coach, Phil Jackson, called the Chicago Bulls to the sidelines. And when he called them, he began to give them what he called a game plan. It was an opportunity, or what I call an imitation to win. Next slide, please. And he got them in the huddle, and he's working out the game plan. Well, how are we going to win? Last quarter, he gives them a strategy in the last quarter for them to win. And what was the strategy? A full court press. Now, you don't know what a full court press is. Let me tell you what a half court press is. That's when the offensive team is coming from the other side and the defensive team meet them halfway and then try to deny them from coming, getting closer to their basket. But in the fourth quarter, nobody does a full court press. These weren't young men anymore. These were older men, and they had to start from the full court and come all the way to the other way. But the strategy from the future Hall of Fame Phil Jackson coach was, since we cannot beat this team offensively. It was one of those games, Eric, where I found myself doing what we shouldn't do as Christians. We shouldn't do this. And I'm in Ohio now, and I find myself saying, Lord, I shouldn't do this. But you know what I'm talking about? You're praying for your team to win. I found myself praying, Karen, for my team to win, because we couldn't do anything with Karl Malone and John Stockton. They were working it. Well, you can't beat them shooting the ball, deny them from getting the ball. That was the full court press. And this is how the game went. Next slide. Because as Phil Jackson was talking to the Bulls, he looked in their face and he said, these guys look tired. And it was game six, so Hank, I'm sure they were thinking, he's the thing. Hey, they can go back to Chicago, play the final game, maybe beat them there. But Chicago Bulls have somebody on their team that didn't know how to lose. His name was Michael Jeffrey Jordan. We called him MJ. He didn't know how to lose. And Phil looks at him, designs a play. It wasn't around his ability to be the good and great offensive player. It was around his ability to deny the other team the ball. And what you may not have known at that time is that the Chicago Bulls had the best three-man defensive team in all of NBA. They had Michael Jordan. They had Scottie Pippen. And who was that other person they had? Dennis Rodman, former Detroit Piston player. And these three guys went on a rampage, and they did something I never seen before. They denied these professional players the ball. They couldn't get the ball inside. The Bulls began to come back. And as they began to come back, it was down to 5.2 seconds, and they were losing by one shot, 1 point. And you know what happened? They put it in the hands of Michael Jeffrey Jordan. He took what they call the shot. The shot is not that it was the shot to see if we would win or go ahead, those of us who were vouching for Chicago Bulls, but it's called a shot because it would be his last shot for the Chicago Bulls. He retired from the Bulls after that. Up it goes, down it goes, in. They won the game. They talked to the team and said, what happened? He said, the coach gave us an invitation to win. For my next hour, that was introduction. I want to give you an invitation to win. Today, my invitation to win is, how do you transform your community? How do you transform your ministries? How do you give an invitation to find the lost, grow the found, and make disciples who make disciples? How do we do that? Because even in the midst of COVID or whatever's going on, Jesus had given us a mandate, and we have to do it. And so, for the next, I'm going to say 35 minutes. I'll cut it short. I want to give you an invitation to win. And for those of you who are Bible scholars or people familiar with, we're going to go from Matthew 28, but what I'm going to talk about is that I want you to forget everything you know about the Great Commission. Everything you know, just park it aside. When you leave, you can pick it back up. You can say, that preacher didn't know what he was talking about. But Matthew 28, what we normally call the Great Commission, Jesus meets his disciples on what we call Mount Arbo. On Mount Arbo in Galilee, remember, Christ dies, and he's resurrected, and he goes and see different people. In addition, he goes and meet new people to add to this team, but he told everybody, meet me in Galilee on Mount Arbo. And then at Mount Arbo, he's with his believers, and he gives them an invitation to win. He looks into their eyes, and he sees what they see, and he knows what they're feeling. And you know what they're feeling? We're not winning. This doesn't look like winning. You die on the cross. We saw you, those of us that stayed around. You went into the grave. They put the boulder there. We don't know how you came out. We don't know how you're living. But we've seen you bring somebody back to life again in Lazarus. But Lord, since then, this is not winning. We thought you would come back to establish the kingdom. We thought that you would come back. And now we're all being controlled. For some of them, Peter and James and others, they were already selecting their pew that they would sit at, or their seat, because they said, you know, can I sit on your right side and on your left side? And they figured they were going to take over this disciple, take over from the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the scribes, and the Roman soldiers. But it wasn't like that. Jesus actually died. 3 days went by, and now the Pharisees and Sadducees said, ooh, let's go kill the disciples. And they were hiding, and they were on the run, and this is not what they have signed up for. And Jesus looked into their eyes, knowing what was going on. And he offers them an invitation to win. And I'm going to tell you about four things about this invitation to win that Jesus did. Verse 16 in chapter 28, it starts off like this. Then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee to the mountain which Jesus had appointed them. When they saw him, they worshiped him. Here we go. But some doubt it. We got any doubters here this morning? Not talking about you in a bad way, just life has caused you to think, is this really it? Did I sign up for this? Is this where we should be going? Trying to encourage the preachers today. And verse 18, Jesus came and spoke to them saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and earth. Before we go forward, and I said, forget everything you know about the Great Commission. Dr. Ken, I like to call this the Great Send-Off. Before we label it, the Great Commission, we really started where when we started impacting China and other places in Asia, it was just a verse. But Jesus meets with them on the mountain, and he's getting ready to send them off. he wants, before he sends them off, he wants to instill in them what we call some confidence. And so what does he say? All authority has been given to me in heaven and earth. I want you to know today that the authority that Jesus was given is the authority that he still has today. The power, in fact, he has more power now. That's what he said. I got it all now. You don't have to worry. I got it all. He looks at his disciples who are frustrated. They're losing. It's the fourth quarter to them. And he says, I have the authority. If you're going to do anything as a church, you're going to do anything as a believer, you got to believe that your captain is still Jesus Christ. You got to believe that Jesus is still in charge and that his church, his faith community, he's left you with somebody. He left you with the Holy Spirit. He's got his guardian angels watching over you. And the church may be wounded, but the church is not dead. And he gives them this heart, this confidence level that he's a victorious Savior. And if you don't believe he's the victorious Savior, if you don't believe he has the power, then guess what? Game over. The game is over. Meaning, what we believe, what we do as a church and as believers, if you don't think Jesus can do anything but fail, game over. If you don't believe he's a healer, if you don't believe that he's a restorer, you don't believe he can take crises and make them blessings, if you don't believe that Jesus is a turnaround God, game over. And I think people in this world today who are frustrated, disillusioned, depressed, need to know that the church serves a victorious Savior. And if not, turn off the light. Close the doors, padlock them, and go on with your life. Because the church is still the vehicle that God is using to empower his children to be believers. So I'm here to tell somebody, whatever's troubling you, whatever's disturbing your peace of mind, your finances, your physical challenges, your emotional baggage, your historical, they done me wrong. Take them, place them on the altar of God, and see what he will do. Not can do, will do. You can still give all your problems to God. You can still give them all your prayers. You can still give them all your anxiety, because Jesus said, all authority has been given to me. So after Christ reinstates his authority, Jesus gives us the strategy of his plan, his fourth quarter speech to these disciples who are tired, weary, concerned. Verse 18, we go back, and Jesus came and spoke to them saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and earth. Verse 19, go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. If you have notes, write this down. Pastor Dale, the go here is not a destination. Go here in the Greek is peruomai. Peruomai simply means now to press on, pass on. It's like traverse. Some of you may have a General Motors or traverse, meaning that you zigzag, you work through your problems, you go through things, you don't stop. It's not like you go mean I'm going to go to the store or I'm going to go to church. Or, you know, I'm going to go buy something. No, go means keep passing on. Keep pressing on. Keep going forward. Find a way through your difficulty. Find some way through your challenges. Keep going forward. In other words, don't let the distractions of life stop you from your task. As he looks into their eyes, Christ knew what was ahead for his disciples. And he both warns them and at the same time encourages them not to stop and not to give up. In today's word, in the age of COVID and the Rona, his words would encourage us to pass on or traverse on through the COVID, pass through the monkeypox. Oh, Lord, they got something new now. Pass through our physical challenges. Pass on through your financial difficulty. Pass on through your headaches. Pass on through your depression and oppression. There is no other name that can do you like Jesus. There is no other person that you and I follow, we pray to, we have faith in, that can help us through the difficulties of life. So pass on through what you're going through. He's our brother, he's our friend, he's the Son of God, and now he's a victorious Savior who tasted death and snatched the keys from Satan and said, I'm waiting on y'all to come on home with me. And this God that you serve, it doesn't matter how hot your fire is, ask Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. The folks that put them in the fire died from the heat, but not them, because who was in the fiery furnace with them? Jesus Christ himself. I don't know how hot your fire is, but I'm sure it's not that hot. I'm sure it's not that hot. If you feel that you're in the lion's den, ask Daniel. He was thrown into the lion's den, and what did God do? He didn't take him out of the den. He didn't remove the lions. What did he do? Caused the lions not to even be hungry. They must have saw a sign on Daniel, don't touch that. And Daniel stayed there through what he went through, the lion's den. And I'm here to tell you today, the problem we have with the church is that we telling folks, you don't get sick, you don't go through stuff, when that's not the message. The message is, if you go through it, Jesus can go through it with you. And if you lose, Paul said to us what? To live is Christ, to die is gain. My Bible mentor, the late Dr. Daryl Hardeman, used to say to me, you simply can't lose with the stuff we use. Do you still believe that today? That as believers of Jesus Christ, you can't lose with the stuff we use. Oh, I used, again, a lot of trouble growing up because I had that kind of faith. I used to get in a lot of trouble. I was in that trouble with Southfield when they went against us. I said, y'all messing with God now. You better be careful now. Better be careful now. Better be careful now. You messing with God. And since we're talking about the 100-year anniversary, Pat and Bessie, you may not understand this, and maybe why you were so nice to us as a church, but those folks that came against us, you know, some of those folks, let's see, the downtown development person, he quit his job, went to Japan to study karate. The developer, for some of you, we had bought some property, and we were doing our thing, and there was a gated community that they wanted there in place of our property. Instead of trying to give us the money, they just said, we're going to kick them out of there. What can this little church do? And they were looking at this little church, but they weren't looking at our big God. And so what happened was almost every person that got in our way. So the one guy went to study karate over in Japan. The developer that came to me and tried to shortchange me on having us to sell our property to him went bankrupt. And the city planner, I'm not mentioning names here, he got fired. And we won the battle. Go back, check your newspaper. And we won the battle. And you know what? And God was proving to us, it didn't matter how much money you had or didn't have. He was proving to us it didn't matter who you know or who you didn't know. Because all we really had to do and all I had to do as the leader at that time and the BTW at that time, or Booker, Turner, and William, all we had to do was trust in God. And God took care of the rest. And I'm hoping this 100-year anniversary pushed some of you forward as you hear more and more stories of how God helped folks. We didn't have a lion's den, we didn't have the fiery furnace, but we had Jesus helping us with some folks who were ruthless. Well, Jesus tells them, peruamai, keep going on. Don't stop. Don't get caught up in what you're going through. Don't get depressed. Peruamai, keep going on. The strategy of his plan continues because he said, go make disciples of all nations. Go make them. You have been empowered by Christ to go where no other name can send you, no other name can empower you, no other name can keep you from falling, no other name is redemptive, no other name is more loving, no other name is so compassionate. Go. You got a go in you, or you done part this somewhere. Lord, I'm dealing with some stuff. When I finish with that, then I'll go. You know, the church is not made of perfect people. The church should be made up of redemptive people, of people who trust in God. From the early beginnings of those three mothers, they got together to save their community for Jesus Christ. To today, everything has to do with going and trusting as you go. Not having a lot of money, not seeing the outcome before you go, going and trusting. Kind of like the commandment of Jesus. He didn't give you an option. He didn't say, you want to. It's a commandment. Go. Now, the strategy, he said, is go. Here we go. Baptize in. In or ains in the Greek. This particular word doesn't mean, it's a preposition, but some of your Bibles, they left off something. And what they left out, Karen, is that this preposition said into. It doesn't say in. I mean, how do you baptize somebody in? It should have been into. And some of you that still have revised and others, you'll see that the Greek said into. And into means this. Jesus said, baptize them into. The Greek word is an insertion or put them among. When you baptize people, insert them or put them among. So the verse said, baptize them into the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now, any of you are Trinitarians, then you know what I just said is that this is the Godhead. Jesus proclaims, hey, there's three of us, y'all. And it's the Father, it's me, it's the Holy Spirit that's getting ready to come, and you need to baptize folks into the Godhead or into the family of God. Somebody ought to get happy right now. Baptize them into, put them among the family of God. When you go and see these people and you witness to them, it's important. We're not talking about John's baptism now for repentance. We're talking about a new baptism. That's why John said, Lord, I need to have you to baptize me because I want to be in that family that you belong to. Jesus said, no, go ahead. I got to do this. We got to do this on earth. But now Jesus opened up a whole different viewpoint. It's getting people into the family of God. Park that for a moment and let me say something to you. If you get married, and some of you, when you got married, at what point, can you still hear me here? Okay, I don't like staying in one place, I'm sorry. You may get me out of here quicker than you know. When you get married, how many of y'all married folks here? Raise your hands. Okay, good. So when you get married, and you say I do, or whatever way you got married, I know you got some fancy ways now of getting married. Amen. I can tell you some stories from folks I married here. But I'm going to try to be quiet because, Jesus. I had folks standing up, and when I went, do you promise to obey? Oh, Lord, all hell broke out. Some of y'all remember that wedding? I messed up big time. That's why I give people the script now. I said, now these are the words. Is there anything here you want to change? Anything you want to talk about? Because I married somebody, and I said, do you promise to obey? And they said, say what? And now I'm up there counseling, and everybody's looking. I mean, it's so embarrassing, folks putting their head down. And remember the person said, I won't make you do a lot. Honey, it'll be okay. She said, well, okay. Woo! We had to work through that thing. But when you get married, and once you're married, once you say I do and you agree, you put the rings on or whatever, how long does it take for you to be legally recognized to have the assets of that married person? Legal rights to that person. Is it maybe after the honeymoon? Is it maybe after 7 days or 90 days? I mean, how long is it before you can say, I'm this person's husband or wife, and I am entitled to what they have? Is it a year, 5 year, 10 year? How long? Immediately. I mean, when you say I do, that's it. Now I'm having hot flashes up here now, because I do remember one time I signed the paper. I went and put it in the mail because I didn't let folks take their marriage certificates to the clerk. I didn't do that stuff, Bessie. I personally put it in the mail myself. But I got a phone call. I don't think it was 2 hours. Emma, they said, Reverend, do you still have them papers? Is it legal? I said, yeah, it's legal. I mean, but we just got married. Yeah, but it's legal. So when you get married, you get all the benefits immediately. There's no 30 days. There's no 12 months. It is immediately. Okay, so y'all trying to process that, and I'm going somewhere. When you have a baby born to your family, or you have a legal adoption, how long does it take for that child to be entitled to the benefit package? Now, it can't be immediately. What, like maybe 7 days? Maybe 30 days? Maybe when they're 18 years old? Lori, is it like 21? Or no. When you have that baby or you adopt that baby, legally sign up, immediately they're entitled to your benefits. Now, for some of you who are the mamas and the daddies and your child getting ready to do this, you need to let them know if it's not too late, immediately. I remember when one of my brothers died and they weren't married, and my mom, you know, called the people and said, I'm the mama, I'm next of kin. They said, well, no, not necessarily. And she said, what are you talking about? I'm the mama. I brought them in this world. I told them I'll take them out. They don't act right. And they said, no, you're not next of kin. My mother said, well, who's the next of kin? They came out of me. I mean, my mother was arguing. My sister Paulette and I, we were like, Mom, calm down. They said, he has children. His children are the rightful heirs. And my mother's trying to figure out what to do, because we're trying to work this thing out. And finally, I had to call, and I had to threaten them, LaVoy. I had to go LaVoy on them. And I said to the undertaker, I said, do you get paid for this, or is it a free service? And they said, no, I got to get paid. I said, well, them folks you dealing with ain't got no money. So either you going to deal with my mama, or you stuck with the body. And they began to work with us. Because the kids, you know, that's what happened. I shouldn't go there, but that's what happened. When you make these babies and you don't have no, well, Lord, let me leave that alone. I'm sorry, I'm leave that alone. And so we got the marriage part immediately. We got the babies immediately. Here we go. This is not hard science, Patricia. It's not hard. How soon are you and I entitled to the blessings of God when you get into the family of God? How long does it take? Does it happen a few years after your confession of faith? Or after the right hand of fellowship? How soon? Immediately. Well, if Jesus is telling these folks to baptize them in, insert them, get them among the family of God, because immediately Jesus knew they get the benefit package. They'll get all the help they need. They'll get all the strength that they need. You need to get them among the family of God. And I'm here to say today, one of the problems we have with baptism is that we don't get folks in soon enough into the water. We're shaking hands. We're having newcomers class. We're having all this. And if you look at the Bible, Jesus told them to go there and baptize them into. Now, I think the problem with our church now is that we have orientation classes for people to belong to a club. Orientation classes, when somebody is giving their heart to God, and now we say, yeah, but now they got to pass my rules. Ooh, he didn't go there. And the reason people aren't coming to the church is because the church got some rules that these people can't even measure up to, and until they measure up to those rules, we don't let them in. And I remember one time somebody said to me, when I get finished with you, you won't be able to read scripture in the church of God. Whew. That's tough. You want your church to grow? You want to accelerate the kingdom of God, meaning people coming into the Lord and people getting to know Jesus more? Let folks in. I'm getting excited now, Mark. I'm trying to know if I'd be going there now. But I see too many places. I go to churches. Hey, how long you been a member here? I've been a member this long. You been baptized yet? No, I've been thinking about it. Excuse me? Yeah, I'm trying to work out some stuff. What stuff you got to work out? You believe that God saved you? Yeah. You ask God for forgiveness of your sin? Yes. But to preach, I'm trying. You don't get into the kingdom of God because you don't try harder. You get in because you believe in Jesus Christ. And remember when Jesus would go to Jerusalem, he'd see different people, and the Pharisees said, well, they're not good enough yet. I wonder if our church is now like that, where they're not good enough to be part of us. Ooh. The strategy Jesus gave was to get folks among the family of God, because when you get them in the family of God, they get the benefit package. I mean, the Holy Spirit started talking to them. And Jesus said that, you know, I'm going to leave now because the Holy Spirit is going to come. And it's his job to do what? Teach them, convict them of sin and of judgment and of righteousness. It's the Holy Spirit's job. Ooh, it's not our job. Now, I've talked to so many pastors here in this state and in Ohio that they say, well, I'm just trying to bring forth some people who good enough to be called a child of God. I said, good enough? When Jesus was doing the great send-off, and he appointed somebody to be in charge of the send-off team. His name was Peter. And Peter didn't even have the courage to be there when Jesus was being persecuted. He was gone. And he lied. Remember Peter lied? They said, were you one of them? No, I'm not one of them. And so Jesus anointed and appointed a thief and a liar. Oh, boy, here we go, church of God. I mean, he did do that to Peter. And when Peter should have had his back, Peter was on the boat fishing butt naked. And Jesus had to go get Peter. What you doing on this boat fishing? I'm sorry, Lord. And then Jesus let Paul in, and Paul was crucifying people and killing people, and Jesus let him in. And we can't let folks in. Here we go. Oh, boy, you may call me on this one. We can't let folks in because they got a smoking problem, a drinking problem, a cussing problem, just a human decency problem. We can't let them in. No, they ain't good enough to be saved. When did we get to be the inspectors? The quality control inspectors. When did we get to that point to do all that kind of stuff? So Jesus' invitation to win was for them to keep going. Don't stop. Need to go. You need to fill up the pews. You need to do different things. Just keep going. Don't let life stop you from testifying about Jesus. And then when you do get those people, insert them. Get them among the family of God. We used to sing that song, "So Glad I'm a Part of the Family of God." We don't sing that anymore because we don't even know what the family of God is anymore. Oh, praise God. The reverend said we do it here. Because when you get them into the family of God, they get the comforter, they get the paraclete, somebody that will walk alongside them, keeping watch over them, and somebody that's going to give them some dunamis power, some power to be saved. You don't come to the church saved, you come to church to get saved and be saved and stay saved and confess your sins. When I grew up in the church, when I sinned, I ran to the altar and I kept asking God to give me strength over this. And if somebody would have touched me and said, no, you go back outside these doors, you get together, and then when you get together, then you come back in. No, that's not the way it happened. The last part of the strategy was teach them. Teach them. The final piece of this strategy is notice the word order of the verse. Insert them into the kingdom of God before teaching comes. Read verse 19 again. Go therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Verse 20, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. I said recently, the problem with our holiness, we are acting like safety inspectors and quality control specialists. Not allowing anybody in unless they act like us, they look like us, they talk like us. And if they don't act like us, look like us, and talk like us, we show them the way out. And one of the times, some of you all may have been here, when our church was really, really growing, is when I made a commitment to God that I would let him clean the folks up. I just get them in. Just get them in. Let God do the rest. Let the Holy Spirit do the rest. That's not your job or my job to tell God they're not good enough for him. Remember the prodigal son? He comes home. His daddy's happy. But the brother that was already home didn't like the way his brother came home. And he didn't want to come to the party. He didn't want to celebrate. And we need to celebrate when folks come to the kingdom. And I don't care if they get up every Sunday saying, "I thank God, y'all just don't know what I went through this week." Celebrate their victory with them. Teaching comes last. Going back to the baby. If you bring a baby into your family or a new child into your family, you don't look at the baby and say, "Are you going to be a good baby? Are you going to obey all the rules? You going to give me any problems?" I mean, you adopting, you may be able to do that, but you can't do that. When that baby come out, that's it. I mean, my youngest child, I remember I was there. I was there with Doreen. I was at the birthing station, and we had it going on. I was writing, and we had two girls, and we're going to get this boy. And I was writing in the journal. I was doing everything. And Doreen, I was helping her to push and do everything right. And when the baby came out, it was a girl. The wife would tell you again, "God can strike me dead." I said, "Put her back in there." The doctor said, "That's not how it works, sir." I mean, when that baby's out, now you got to live with that baby. And each child has their own personality, their own ways. And what do? You teach them. You teach them. You don't say you are the family. You teach them. You learn in their ways, their idiosyncrasies, and you're going, oh, Lord, you got that from your daddy, or you got that from your mama, or you got that from your great. You know how you do all that. But wherever they got it from, you're teaching them. The church should be a vehicle of teaching people how. And church, you can't lose with the stuff we use. Teach people how. How? When the wife and I got married, we didn't know nothing about how to be married. The saints taught us how to be married. 43 years just went by our anniversary. We ain't had nobody in our family be married no 40. We ain't had nobody in our family, I think, married 20 years. At least me. You know who taught us how to be married? The saints. The church. If the church is not teaching, then the church is not the church. You're a club. And that's what you're going to have to say to yourself. What are we going to be? And as I close this great send-off that Jesus had with his disciples, he went up, and the angel of the Lord saw them there, wondering, where do we go next? And he said, why sit ye gazing up into the sky? Go. Go. Pastor Dale, I say to you, go. Go forward. Go boldly. Go. If there's something I taught you that ain't right, get rid of it. Amen. They're not going to call me and tell me about you, because I already stopped those folks that was calling me. You know, you just go forward now. You know, you don't have the BTW team anymore. You got different acronyms. You guys do what the Lord is telling you to do, but go forward, because you're not going to get another 100 years. You're not going to get another 10 years if we don't start saving folks. Now, the church is empty all across America, and that's because we won't let sinners come inside. Let them come in. Get them among the family of God. And if they do, you guys know how I got saved. I didn't know all the stuff about being saved, Bessie. I didn't know nothing. But I came up and said, whatever y'all got, that's what I want. And there's some people that want whatever y'all have. Let them in, and then teach them, and then equip them to go out and let some more of their friends in. And that's how you do it, with you close your eyes. Thank you, Father, for 100 years. We thank you for those three courageous women who said, we're going to change our neighborhood. We thank you for the legacy they have left. We thank you for some of their family members being here today. And now, Lord, as we just look at this church, we pray for every person that belongs to Lighthouse, that you may give them all they need, Lord, to walk with their pastor, understand what their pastor is going through, equip their pastor, Lord, so that she can do the work of not just an evangelist, but a preacher. Bless this church, Lord, as she continues to live out being the light of the world and the salt of the earth. Give each person what they need. And Lord, if there's somebody out here today, they just came for the celebration. Lord, help them to become part of the family of God. And I pray for everyone else, Lord, who may not necessarily belong to this church, but Lord, they're part of a faith community. May they take today's message with them. Win the lost, grow the found. In Jesus' name, amen.